Hey, have you ever been out driving and seen one of those decals in a car window of a kid urinating on some random logo, usually a sports team or political affiliation? Believe it or not, this image means a lot to me. I mean, not the peeing part, the kid doing the peeing. Wait, God damn it. That's Calvin, the titular character of the beloved daily comic strip Calvin and Hobbes. And no other piece of media has inspired me quite like it. It was created by Bill Watterson and ran briefly from 1985 to 1995. Taking influence from Charles Schulz's Peanuts, George Harriman's Crazy Cat, and Walt E. Kelly's Pogo, it follows the life of Calvin, an imaginative and mischievous 6-year-old boy, and Hobbes, his best friend, a stuffed tiger. Hobbes would be real to Calvin, but to everyone else, they merely saw a toy. Calvin got poor grades in school, but when speaking to Hobbes, you could tell he was a bright kid with a very creative mind. His lack of filter and immaturity would often lead to him getting into trouble.
Boy, that sounds really familiar.
Hobbes acted as a voice of reason, wiser and more thoughtful. He'd often give a sardonic, cautionary response to Calvin's shenanigans. The strip was about their enduring friendship while Calvin dealt with childhood issues. Relationships with his parents, neighborhood kids, teachers, bullies, as well as difficulties with school, being babysitted, going on summer vacation, playing outside, building snowmen, corporate bureaucracy.
Oh wait, never mind, that last one was from Dilbert.
When I was about 6 or 7, I stumbled across a book collection of strips, It's a Magical World, and I immediately got swept up in this comic creation. I had to read more. I must get a hold of every different book collection I can. I would spend my weekends reading and rereading aloud each book, while acting out all the parts.
Nothing like relaxing on a Saturday afternoon reading Calvin and Hobbes.
The artwork was just great. Bill Watterson often experimenting with different styles, really pushing the boundaries of what a comic strip could be, especially with huge layouts and Sunday strips. Going neo-cubist in one, or doing a parody of serious dramatic soap opera comics like Judge Parker and Mary Worth, or overly violent superhero comics, or just drawing a kick-ass Tyrannosaurus Rex. But him just drawing the everyday activities of Calvin are what had the biggest effect on me. Calvin's face would be so expressive. The vast array of emotions he could convey were so detailed and expansive. And he perfectly captured the feline patterns of behavior in Hobbes. Without question, no artist has influenced me more than Bill Watterson. I've pretty much aped his style in everything I've drawn since first grade. I'm not even trying to do it on purpose. It's almost sickening, really.
Like, guys, look at this. I was trying to draw a house.
I related immensely with Calvin. He pretty much was me at that age. Only child, had a big mouth, not spectacular at school, wasn't particularly popular, but was a daydreamer and had a lot of artistic and creative pursuits. And I had a cat, too. Albeit a Siamese, not a tiger. But hey, close enough. Calvin's imagination led him to be different alter egos.
Exploring the universe as Spaceman Spiff.
Or Trace a Bullet, the film noirish Private Eye. Or Saving the World as Stupendous Man.
There are a lot of great recurring gags throughout the comic's run. Getting pounced by Hobbes every time Calvin came home from school. Them having philosophical discussions while riding a wagon through the forest at high speed, usually resulting in them going off a literal cliff. Them playing Calvin Ball, a sport they invented, where you made up the rules as you went along. Calvin struggling on whether or not to throw a snowball at the neighbor girl Susie if it means he might not get presents from Santa Claus.
Calvin would usually take his chances.
Him being disgusted by whatever dinner his mother worked hard to prepare for. Even food you'd think he'd like. Calvin being hunted and pursued by a bicycle he's afraid to learn to ride. Giving his dad updates of polling results for his performance as a father among the house's 6-year-old demographic. Other times, Calvin's dad would enthusiastically force the family to go camping out into the wilderness because it helped build character, despite it being endlessly miserable for everyone but him. Every night before bed, Calvin would force his dad to read the book Hamster Huey and the Gooey Kablooey, much to his chagrin. Although Calvin would sometimes change up the reading schedule. There was also references to the noodle incident, which was some mysterious incident that happened at school that Calvin denies any involvement for, claiming he was framed. It was deliberately left unexplained to the reader and only ever alluded to, making your mind wonder, what in God's name happened during the noodle incident? Calvin and Hobbes is rightfully praised, particularly for its philosophical and artistic discussions between the two, among academics and people who just grown up reading the comics and missed a lot of the nuances that went over their head as children.
All right, it went over my head. I wasn't very bright. You happy?
But what I think gets often overlooked are the long story arcs throughout the series. Bill Watterson could tell larger stories made up of daily strips. They could last a week or two, or go on for several months. Some would be low stakes and silly. Like for class picture day, Calvin put Crisco in his hair so he'd look like Astro Boy. Or they'd be more dramatic, with an emotional core. Like when Calvin finds a dying baby raccoon and has his first experience coping with death and loss. Here are some highlights throughout the years. For a school assignment, Calvin has to bring in an insect collection he had a month to prepare for, which he completely forgets about. And he rushes to collect enough bugs the morning it's due. In an alternate scenario, Calvin actually does prepare for a class project when he has to present a report on bats. He mistakenly thinks he'll cinch a good grade as long as his report comes in a clear plastic binder. This backfires when his poor research is exposed, claiming that bats are bugs. In another, Calvin has to act in the school's production of the 5 food groups, where he plays an onion, although he struggles to memorize his one line.
Oh man, I've been there, buddy.
And he ends up getting stuck in the bathroom when he's supposed to be on stage. But he remembered his line! These longer story arcs are often when it'd show Calvin's battles with his dreaded babysitter, Rosalind. In one, he steals her exam notes and threatens to flush them down the toilet if she doesn't give in to his demands to stay up late and watch TV. And in another, he locks her outside while on the phone trying to convince her boyfriend to break up with her. Calvin would ultimately get his comeuppance, usually having his plans foiled when his parents arrive home. There's also the deranged, mutant, killer, monster, snow goons arc. Calvin always was exceptional at building snowmen, often in the most elaborate and creative ways. Jeez Louise, look at that. I couldn't even build a basic snowman. I mean, look at this lump of shit. Calvin reanimates one snowman, who turns evil, adding another head and creating an army of more snow goons. Calvin and Hobbes must fight these monstrosities or face certain death. So they spray him with a hose. And one Calvin, sick of his parents' tyranny, decides to leave and move to the Yukon with Hobbes. striking up on their own, Calvin proves to be way out of his element. I love the sandwiches Calvin makes for himself. I wonder what they taste like.
It sucks.
In another storyline, Calvin and Hobbes form a secret club. Gross. Get rid of slimy girls. While trying to find a place for their clubhouse, they push his mom's car out of the garage, but it rolls downhill, right into a ditch, forcing them to go on the run. Another good one. Calvin eats his favorite cereal, chocolate frosted crunchy sugar bombs. And if he collects enough box tops, in return he gets a propeller beanie he really wants, imagining that it makes him fly. He force feeds himself bowl after bowl. Once he has enough box tops, he has to wait 6 weeks for the beanie to finally arrive, agonizing every waited minute. When it eventually arrives, he has to assemble it himself, but while arguing with Hobbes, he accidentally breaks a piece of the propeller. Calvin lashes out, blaming Hobbes. Hobbes correctly points out that he didn't do anything, and Calvin is just deflecting. Calvin's dad is able to fix the broken piece, but he's ultimately disappointed because the beanie doesn't quite work the way he expected. All's not lost, though. Boxes would provide several different uses in various other storylines. With the opening on top, it worked as a time machine, as they both traveled back to the Jurassic Age to take photos of dinosaurs. Flipped over, the box was a transmogrifier, turning Calvin into any animal he wanted. He decides to turn into a tiger, much like his furry friend. And when the box was on its side, it worked as a duplicator. Sick of school and household chores, Calvin hopes a duplicate can do all those tedious activities while Calvin and Hobbes goof off. It doesn't work quite as planned. The duplicate ends up making more duplicates. To not complicate things, they all agree with Calvin for everyone to alternate on different days of who goes to school. After repeatedly getting in trouble, Calvin's mom goes to confront him, and the duplicates are all forced to hide under the box. Since the box is flipped over, it's back to being a transmogrifier, which Calvin uses to turn the duplicates into worms. I think my favorite arc, though, when Calvin tries out to play baseball with the other schoolboys, a storyline I related to a lot. Calvin feels pressured to join, as he's made fun of for not doing so. When he finally does, he misses the inning's change as he remains in the outfield and unknowingly catches an out against his own team. This angers the other boys, who now hate him. This storyline perfectly encapsulates the juvenile competitive bullshit and that macho douchiness in competitive sports that I always despised. It concludes well, though, as Calvin ends up playing Calvin ball with his best buddy Hobbes, a game for fun with someone who actually likes him. All these storylines were pretty much the closest thing we got to this comic strip being a television show. As a kid, I always wondered, why isn't there an animated series of Calvin and Hobbes? Snoopy had a cartoon. Garfield had a cartoon. Why the hell doesn't Calvin and Hobbes have a cartoon? Apparently it was almost in the works, but Bill Watterson nixed the idea. He just couldn't imagine some child actor, or whoever, capturing the voice of Calvin, a character he held very dear.
If only there was a 6-year-old boy back then who could have played Calvin. Too bad he didn't exist. Oh wait, he did! Me! I would have been perfect! I wasn't doing anything! Yeah, going to school, look how well that worked out. You fucked up, Bill.
You fucked it up! You fucked it up!
I kid, of course. We ultimately didn't need an animated adaptation. The original run was more than enough.
Bill Watterson retired Calvin and Hobbes after only a decade, which is absurdly short for a daily comic strip. For perspective, Garfield has been running for 40 years. Peanuts capped off at 50. Family Circus is 60. Fucking Blondie is 90. And God help us if a cartoonist has kids, because they will teach them how to draw new strips so that they can continue to milk the property to death long after the original creator is deceased.
I demand the mass sterilization of any and all comic strip artists.
Not Bill Watterson, though. Like Jim Brown, Bill Watterson quit at the top of his game, at the height of his ability and peak of his prime, walking away from the thing he loved, never to return. Although he occasionally dropped in to draw guest strips for other comics, Watterson rarely makes public appearances or does interviews, instead living with his wife outside of the public eye and acting as a sort of comics version of J.D. Salinger. He was never going to be a guy that was going to commercialize the hell out of his own creation, which is why you never see any Calvin and Hobbes merchandise, except for the aforementioned bootleg piss decal. So thank you, Bill Watterson. Your work has entertained and inspired me and countless others, and will continue to do so long after we're all gone. So if you've never read Calvin and Hobbes, what are you doing? Get on it! You're not busy with anything. What are you, reading the latest Jonathan Franzen novel? Get the fuck out of here with that bullshit. Read Calvin and Hobbes. Do it. Do it now!